Oh, hey. What brings you over so early? Kalman filters. Are you sure? All right. Well, help me close up.
All right, everybody. So here we are with Kalman filters to get this job done a little better. Now, a couple things I'll say up front is that kind of like J2, that whole conversation, you can go deeper and deeper and deeper. You can choose this as kind of to make a career out of. So this is a big topic. And whatever 12 or 15 minutes this is actually a good amount of material. Okay, but with this medium, there's not really any use in me just repeating stuff over and over or speaking slowly. Because you can do that yourself. You can watch it again, pause it, rewind a little bit. And you probably are not, there's no way, I don't want you to be discouraged. There's no way you're going to take all this in 12 or 15 minutes and feel like you pretty much have a good grip on it. Okay, so you're gonna have to look at this a few times, look at the note taker, look at the book if you're really digging into it. Our main goal really though is to get our foot in the door enough that we at least know the language, we know what the main moving parts are in the final conclusions we get to, and then we can jump right into the application, which is pretty similar to what we've been doing. You've had enough drawn out math classes, I'm sure, that didn't seem to have any application. So, wow, just getting our foot in the door though is going to take 3 or 4 lessons, and then we'll get on to the next project for those of you that are hanging around with me. All right, so what is our goal? We're looking to get a system where we can get a new observation, incorporate that into all the stuff we already knew, and get a updated state vector for now, COEs for now. And we also want to have those nice statistics, that covariance matrix. In the batch sequential stuff we talked about last time, we updated the statistics, the covariance matrix, but everything was referenced to the epoch. Okay, so although it was updated for the epoch. So if the epoch was 5 years ago, we take all this information, including something today, and we decide that the error in our solution is 1 kilometer. All right, but that doesn't really mean that the COE, the prediction that I make for tomorrow to look for the space station should be plus or minus 1 kilometer. So that's what we're gonna be able to do with the Kalman filter. Okay, now just to remind ourselves of what we have done or are doing as you're finishing up the current project, you have some observations, right? You have some observations. And you started with some sort of a guess, sort of based on the observations in this case. We used Herod Gibbs, and we said, well, there's our guess. But then we start doing our least square calculations, and we figure out that this green line is actually the best solution to the all the observations. So how did we get from orange to green? Well, we did the least square differential corrections, and we figured out how we have to change the state of our initial guess, how we have to change that, and then we change it at the epoch, and now we have the epoch state vector that will fly through all these observations in a pretty decent way. All right, that del x hat. Now we're trying to get to a place where we're dealing in this epoch, the current observation. And so that's what we're gonna have to figure out. We want to take the state now and make a correction to it to get the corrected state. But this, unless our guess and the solution we want are parallel, the delta, how we have to change this is not gonna be the same as what we're sitting on with the epoch corrections. All right. So we're gonna have a really good system here for just taking one step at a time. We're gonna have something that we think is a pretty good answer. An observation is gonna come in. We're going to compare our prediction to the observation, make a correction at the observation, and get a new answer, and then wait for the next observation to come in, and then leapfrog to that one and do the same thing all over again. So more visually, you have this state vector that you can project into the future. Okay, and so we're going to go get a new observation. We know what we think it should be, but we have an actual observation. We're going to go through very similar least square sort of algebra, linear algebra, and we're going to get the del x hat at that spot that we need to correct the state at this spot. And then we're going to let that new solution progress into the future. And then we get another observation. And using our predicted based off of the last observation, compare that to what we see, get the delta at time two that we need to adjust, and then now we have a new solution here. We're also keeping track of the covariance all the time. So we see that as we go into the future, figuratively this covariance is getting worse, but then we make a correction, we incorporate new data, and hopefully have a lower covariance. And we see this is kind of trending down in time because we're collecting more and more points as we go into the future. So what do we have to be able to do to pull this together? Well, we have to be able to take a reference trajectory, the Herrick-Gibbs, or as we update this, that reference trajectory can change. And we have to be able to propagate it into the future so that we can see how good it is compared to some new observation. All right, so can we do that? Yes, we can. If you have a current solution, you can project it into the future using COWL. So that is awesome. And that's about it for this list of things. We need to be able to predict the state correction that delta x hat for a time that's not epoch. Okay, everything was built around epoch so far. We need to be able to project that into the future. That's mainly what we're going to talk about today. And we also need to be able to do the same thing with the covariance matrix. There's no reason to think that a different time has the same errors. And then we need to be able to correct what we already have when some new data comes in. State correction and covariance matrix. So let's tackle 1.B.
Your score isn't what we hoped to see from you, cadet. Take the mission again, and this time, think about your decisions.
All right. So this may look worse than it is, but this is hard stuff. Again, nothing's hard if you take small enough bites. But admittedly, when we see one of these, we get a little worried. But this isn't really too bad. All we're saying here is that the correction I need to make to the state vector in the future is probably some state transition matrix coupled with the current del x. All right, so you were at epoch, you did all this math, you have a del x at epoch time. And I'm just saying that in the future, if I was trying to correct observation three, there's probably some function that can convert this, multiply by that, into the correction I need to make in the future. The state correction parameter is what this is. All right, so I need, what are we doing here? I need the state correction as a function of time. Okay. So if we look at a first order Taylor series expansion, the correction I need to make at this, let's say, observation two, is going to be approximately what I needed to make at observation one plus how fast it's changing times delta t. So no astrodynamics here. We're just saying that I want the thing in the future, so I'm going to model that as what it is now plus how fast it's changing times how long I gave it to change. All right. But now we're stuck with this. We don't have an expression for how this is changing. And it is going to change, except for very weird circumstances, because you can see that this was my initial guess. This is my solution. But if I want to go from orange to green here, it's a different change than if I'm going from orange to green in the future. All right, so instead of saying Herrick Gibbs and some other longer word, I'm just going to call what we the current model that we have is X, and we're trying to find the better one, Y, using new data. Okay, so we can say that Y is equal to X plus some del X. So at any time in the future, that's a true kind of trivial statement, that Y is equal to X plus some difference. That difference is what we're looking for. All right, now X dot, how is the solution we already have, how is that changing with time? Well, it's a function of the current state. You know, for our problem, X is the positions and the three velocities. And that is all you need to find the state in the future, the two-body equation motion. And we're going to say that Y dot, how is it changing? This one we don't know, but we want to know. How is it changing? It's going to be a function of its states. And it's going to have the same equations of motion as X dot. All right, so still being kind of in the trivial rearranging stuff here, not any Kalman filter stuff yet. But I can say that Y dot, instead of a function of Y, I can use this fact to say that Y dot is a function of X plus the difference between X and Y. Okay. So another first order Taylor series expansion, because we know that X and Y should be pretty close. We didn't just randomly stumble on X. We have some intelligent guess, and we know that we need to modify it a little bit to get the ideal answer. So Taylor series expansion there, Y dot is equal to some function of X, just X dot, okay, plus how that function changes with respect to all of its states times del X. And we're going to start using this shorthand here so that I can just rewrite it a little quicker. Y dot is equal to basically X dot plus some array of partial derivatives times whatever the del X is at that time. Okay, why did we do that? All right, well, if Y is equal to X plus del X, then we can also say that Y dot is equal to X dot plus del X dot. And so this is where we were stuck at the last page. So if we just throw that down here, we get F of X plus capital F del X is equal to X dot plus del X dot, right? Now F of X is X dot. So these disappear. And now I have a function for del X dot. How fast is that correction I need changing with time, depending on where I want to make the correction at? So del X dot is equal to some array of partial derivatives multiplied by del X itself.
Spock to Enterprise.
Enterprise, come in, Mr. Spock.
Prepare to beam us up, Mr. Scott. We're warping out of orbit.
Leaving? You can't be serious, Spock.
Doctor, that asteroid is almost as large as your Earth's moon. Far enough away, the angle necessary to divert it enough to avoid destruction is minute. But as the asteroid approaches this planet, the angle becomes so great that even the power of a starship...
The devil with an asteroid! It won't get here for 2 months, Spock!
If we arrive at the deflection point in time, it may not get here at all.
In the meantime, what about Jim?
Once the asteroid has been diverted, we'll return here and resume the search.
That may be hours from now. He may be injured or dying.
Doctor, assume this is the planet we're on. This is the approaching asteroid. If we don't get to that deflection point in time, it will become physically impossible to divert this asteroid. In that case, everyone on this planet will die, including the captain.
Can a few more minutes matter, Spock?
In the time it has taken me to explain the problem, the asteroid has moved from here to here. The longer we delay, the less the likelihood of being able to divert it.
Okay. So why did we need del x dot in the first place. We just figured out an expression for it. Why did we need it? Because of the first Taylor series expansion we did. So I can say that the correction I need to make in the future, at some time in the future, some observation time, when all I have is the epoch update, that del x is equal to the del x I have plus the rate, its rate of change times delta t. Now I have an expression for that, built of partial derivatives. Then I can factor out the del x naughts, right? There's two of those. And I can write it like this. And then initially we presented the problem as having this form, that the del x in the future is equal to some state transition matrix times the del x now. And so we see that that means that our psi, our state transition matrix, is equal to the identity matrix plus some array of partial functions times the delta t. The delta t between basically the epoch, when I have a correction that would work, up to the point in the future that I'm trying to make it. Okay. Now we didn't talk about f very much though. This is what we decided. This is where we were stuck, and we decided just to call it capital F of t. So this is the partial of this function of x, which was x dot, with respect to x itself, each x. Okay. So what is, this f of x was another way of writing x dot. So for our system, what is x dot? Well, x is the three positions and the three velocities. So x dot becomes three velocities and three accelerations. So for me to build up an F, I need to get the partial of the velocities and accelerations with respect to the positions and velocities. So I can segment this a little bit and save us some time. This corner will be the velocities with respect to the position. This will be a 3x3 of the velocities with respect to the velocities, a 3x3 here of each acceleration with respect to position, and so on. All right. So let's tackle this upper left one first. Okay. So for our problem, the orbit problem, the two-body equation of motion, how is each velocity affected by position? And they aren't directly. Position drives your acceleration, which eventually affects your velocity, but there's no initial bang. If you're here, your velocity is such and such. Okay, so that whole upper left corner becomes zero. Even easier is, what is the partial of each velocity with respect to each velocity? That just becomes the identity matrix. Okay, so we're rolling along pretty well now. Lower left, oh, all right. So the partial of each acceleration with respect to each position. So position is what drives acceleration. So there are some derivatives here. Okay. So what is our acceleration? In vector form, it is this. Okay. We are not going to throw perturbations out of CAL, out of our actual propagation system. But for building this matrix, it is a really small effect. Okay. So we're just going to take the partial of the two-body equation of motion for each of those components with respect to each of the components of position. So we're building this very similar to how we built the A matrix, okay? Except there's no row as and L's now. It's just actually states with respect to states. We're totally in that state space the whole time. Okay, and this will be a 3x3, right? So I'm going to do one of these for you. I'm going to show you how you work one of these out. And I think it's left to you to pull out the pencil and do the others. But, it's pretty darn similar, if you have a template to work off of. So what is the partial of a sub x with respect to r sub x? Okay. So the x component of the two-body equation of motion is minus mu over r cubed times the x component of R. And so what I did here is I expanded this R cubed out, because that's the magnitude of R from the center of the Earth. And then I put it all in one line. Whenever I get rid, that's your pro tip, right? Whenever I get rid of a fraction and have a negative exponent, I'm about to do some calculus. But I won't read out every single one of these. I think it's pretty straightforward, right? You take the minus 3/2, put it in front, take one off of it. I think you're pretty fresh on differentiation at this point. And you just go all the way out through R sub x, or all the way out until you finish differentiating everything with respect to x, R sub x. And then now that I'm done with that, I can put this back into the R shorthand. And then this is my answer. That is the partial of acceleration in the x direction with respect to R in the x direction. And so that is one of the 9 numbers that goes into my big F matrix. A lot of zeros and ones in there, but not these 9 numbers, the lower left-hand corner. Okay. Let's talk about the lower right-hand corner. That is going to be the partials of acceleration with respect to velocity. Okay. If you look at the two-body equation of motion, there aren't any. Acceleration is only driven by your location, distance from the center of the Earth. If we're really getting fancy with this, there could actually be some accelerations that depend on how fast you're going, like drag, right? But for the F matrix, we don't need to get into that. But again, we're not throwing perturbations out of Cowell, just the development of this F matrix. So this is kind of what it looks like once you're done building it. A 3x3 of zeros, an identity matrix, a 3x3 of zeros, and then those 9 partials, 8 of which you are still left to the imagination. Okay, so what did all that get us? So at this point, you can actually build that F matrix. You could be sitting right in your CAL driver or CAL, and at any given point, you know all your X, Y, Z components, and you could build that F matrix. Okay. And so with that F matrix, we go back a few pages, and you see that you can just plug that in with the known state correction at a certain time, and then propagate that state correction into the future. So you can now get that state correction in the future and add it to the state at that, your state estimate at that time, and then now get a corrected, the state at that moment, that third observation or whatever. And that's a little different than just taking the epoch and propagating it forward. But should, you're still after the same goal there. Now, we need to do a whole other conversation on how we do a similar sort of thing with the covariance matrix. Because the covariance matrix at epoch, that 1 kilometer per second of error that I'm really confident in, is not going to be necessarily where I'm sitting at time 2. And then, of course, we have a lesson or two to actually think about how we implement this algorithmically. All right. So next time, we'll cover that covariance, how we update our covariance to any time in the that we pick. And then we get down to the equations. And once we get to that point, we start using H's instead of A's, but really a lot of the least square sort of linear algebra will look very familiar, except we have to build this F matrix to be able to shift in time. I guess that's the key to time travel, right? It's that F matrix. So if I started off with that sense, I would have probably got a lot more excitement from the audience. But yeah, that F matrix is what we can build now, and it allows us to shift through time. I will leave it there.